Simon & Schuster Audio presents Raising Anti-Racist Children, A Practical Parenting Guide by Britt Hawthorne with Natasha Iglesias. Read by Stephanie Keiko Kong.
Author's note. When writing this book, we relied upon our anti-racist child-rearing communities, personal experiences, our memories, and our stories. To preserve the anonymity of certain individuals, we've modified identifying information of anyone who is not a close friend or family member. We acknowledge that the specifics and dynamics of oppression, community, and language are constantly changing. When deciding on using certain terms in the book, we based our decision on contemporary acceptance of the terms at the time of writing, our education about the topics at hand, and our intuition. We recognize that we're always learning, and that some of these terms will change post-publication as conversations evolve and resistance transforms. Lastly, we want to define what we mean by parent. We recognize that families come in many forms, and we intend for the word parent to be inclusive of the many types of caregivers, in addition to society's traditional understanding of parents: grandparents, godparents, aunts, uncles, step-parents, cousins, siblings, and chosen parents or family, to name a few. When we use the words parent or caregiver in this book, we mean to include anyone who has a hand in raising the next generation. A Note to Parents. Welcome. By reading this book, you're joining a community working to reimagine how homes will become liberated spaces. We want you to know that it's never too early to start creating a home rooted in justice, compassion, and love. So whether you're expecting or a seasoned caregiver, this book is for your family. Together, we'll practice empowered parenting by modeling, discussing, and taking action. Before you know it, your children will naturally take to anti-biased and anti-racist, ABAR, ideals. Our goal is to take the overwhelming feelings many parents have shared, anxiety about where to start and who to trust, as well as despair, helplessness, and hopelessness, away. Your goal will be to focus on becoming more comfortable and confident discussing racism, prejudice, and oppression with your family without the guilt and shame involved in these conversations, and to create everyday experiences that promote love and justice. Your awareness and examination will help your family take collective action against everyday and systemic injustices. I'm Britt, and as a nationally recognized anti-bias and anti-racist facilitator, I partner with action-oriented educators to create classroom environments that are inclusive and equitable for all learners. But as a mama, I felt alone and unseen. Parenting books never quite affirmed who I was becoming as a mother and who I wanted my children to become. Sure, I wanted my children to become independent thinkers and doers, and I wanted them to develop a love of reading and playing outside. I wanted them to enjoy themselves. But I also wanted children who welcomed people, set healthy boundaries with their friends, discussed consent with their partners, knew how to rebel against injustice, and above all, children who deeply loved their neighbors. I wanted them to enjoy life and all of its diversity. Many of the parenting books out there focus on individualism. In this book, I'm looking to focus on collectivism. If I've learned anything, it's that alone we know a little, but together we know a lot. This work doesn't belong to any one person or group. It's everyone's work to do together. This book will share some of the ways I've unknowingly upheld white dominant culture inside my home, but it'll also share our favorite toys and materials my family uses to practice accurate language, the critical conversations I'm holding with my children, and even how I select books for my home collection. This book is a collection of my experience as a classroom educator, an anti-bias and anti-racist teacher educator, and my life experience of being a mama in the margins. We invite you to share what resonates with you and activates your brain with your loved ones. We invite you to share your journey of learning and unlearning with your loved ones too. As you engage with this book, I ask you to commit to and model radical self-love, collective care, and community solidarity. Radical self-love is taking care of yourself, such as drinking water, responding with curiosity, and taking deep breaths, especially when feeling troubled or challenged. We can practice this right now as you read these words. Go ahead. Take 3 deep breaths. Taking care of ourselves also means allowing ourselves to grow into who we wish to become. It's easier said than done. Defensiveness, denial, and judgment are easier to choose than reflection, humility, and patience. Allow the truth to take up space. When you find yourself learning from someone, receive the truth as a gift and have a gratitude statement ready. Thank you so much for giving me the gift of truth so I can continue to grow. I appreciate you. You might also respond with, "Thank you for taking care of me. I have the ability to change my behavior, and I will." As we're taking care of ourselves, we must also take care of each other. Collective care means we're responsible for one another. We have a responsibility to hear the truth from others and to share the truth with others. That includes our children. Silence and complacency won't create the homes we're hoping for. If critical conversations seem daunting, you'll find a few strategies in part 5 later in this audiobook that can help set you in the right direction. Collective care also means creating space for conversations to happen, sharing resources, and making yourself available to support your loved ones and your anti-racist community at large. Lastly, community solidarity. We work to center people of the global majority. I'll go into this term later. To cite our sources, and to work toward justice. As an act of solidarity, I'm working to reposition the parenting conversation to include more voices. Together with my co-writer Tasha, I've invited fellow parents and caregivers of the global majority to share their anti-racist journey with us. We all need more contemporary examples of everyday families taking anti-racist action. When your learning leaves these pages, we ask you to cite the writers and sources shared in this book. One final note. Anti-racism belongs to those who choose it. It isn't a destination. It's a lifelong path. Action, dedication, and community are required to become an anti-racist family. By choosing to create our own paths, we'll find other families seeking to create brave spaces of their own. A community to hold us accountable and to laugh out loud while doing it. We're rooting for you. Britt and Tasha. Introduction. In the spring of 2017, our 4-year-old woke up one morning for school and said, "Mommy, Ms. Garcia told me to shut up." I was shocked. I didn't want to believe another teacher, especially a coworker of mine, could speak to a child that way. I asked him to tell me more. He put one of his stuffed animals on his bed, then pretended to be Ms. Garcia. He whispered, "Kobe, I need you to shut up." As I rubbed his back and thanked him for reporting it to me, I knew there would need to be radical change. This kind of everyday educational aggression isn't uncommon for Black children or even the worst kind of aggression they face. Black children have experienced far worse educational racism, resulting in Black learners being suspended at 4 times the rate of white learners nationally. Indigenous, Black, and Brown children continue to experience curricular violence and appropriation in textbooks, theatrical plays, class read-alouds, and holiday celebrations. This is what our children are up against, and it's called the school-prison nexus. Families of the global majority still have to push for their schools to address racism, even when their students and teachers experience it daily. Racism is a part of everyday life here in the United States. Critical race theory is an academic and legal theory that's been around since the 1990s. This theory, which we agree with, states that racism doesn't happen only on an interpersonal level, but also on a systemic level. It challenges the notion that racist attacks are unfortunate and rare, that they happen only to a few people, and that the attackers will always make it clear they're perpetrating a hate crime. Instead, critical race theory gives legal students, lawyers, and academic scholars a framework to analyze how racism is baked into policies, laws, and the legal and punishment system. CRT is not being taught in K-12 classrooms. It's an academic and theoretical framework specifically for those in the legal field. However, the very idea of critical race theory and anti-racism is under attack. This attack is part of a larger historical pattern of white rage and white backlash. Currently, it's against the Black Lives Matter movement's progress. Anti-racism, not to be confused with CRT, offers people the chance to analyze racism on a deeper, more accessible, and systemic level. We now have more people who understand that success occurs not simply because of personal responsibility and hard work, but also because of power, immunity, and oppression. There are more educators equipped with the tools, resources, training, and desire to teach a more truthful and accurate history. But what happens when you have educators who are not only resistant, but emboldened in their ignorance by state-sponsored policies to not address racism in the classroom, even when it's occurring right in front of them? After school, the four of us, Ms. Garcia, the two lead teachers, Ms. Lacey and Ms. Jess, and I, stumbled through a critical conversation. Ms. Garcia admitted to telling Kobe to shut up after trying and failing to get him to be quiet during nap time multiple times. Apparently, her frustration got the best of her. Ms. Lacey, Ms. Jess, and I all made it crystal clear that educators never tell a student to shut up, no matter how frustrated we get, and that it's perfectly normal for a four-year-old to talk a lot. It was something that should have been a given. When Ms. Jess offered possible solutions like bringing Kobe to the kindergarten reading group, taking him to another classroom to work, walking the hallways, or letting him quietly color on his nap map, we learned that Ms. Garcia had in fact used these solutions for other talkative children, just not for Kobe in this situation. As an anti-bias and anti-racist guide, my mind always buzzes with the characters in the story and the role we all play. So I asked, if Kobe was talking, who was he talking to? Noah, she replied. Noah was Kobe's best friend at the time, a blonde-haired boy from France who was a year older than him. Did you also tell Noah to shut up? I asked. Ms. Garcia looked me straight in the eyes and said, no. When we allow ourselves to think about how young children develop bias, learn prejudice, and treat others unfairly, we must think about the bias and prejudice they experience and witness. What example did Ms. Garcia set when she treated these children differently? How do young children begin to inaccurately rationalize these experiences, and how does this make them feel about their own identities? My experience as a Black biracial mother, teacher, and justice educator was too exhausted to overanalyze this situation. This was not the first time my children faced prejudice in the classroom, and I knew that it unfortunately wouldn't be the last. How many more times would I have to tell educators to treat my children with dignity and respect? How many times would I wonder if my children are being treated unfairly? Would I continue to watch them normalize these experiences? That moment with Ms. Garcia was the last straw. I decided then to make a radical choice for our family. We'd remove our children from the classroom and homeschool them. In 2017, I joined thousands of Black homeschoolers who also chose to resist the anti-Blackness deeply embedded in schools. It's one thing to intellectualize white supremacy. It's another to experience what supremacy takes and takes. And takes. This change took Kobe and his brother Carter out of their beloved school and away from their friends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.